futurist can be described as someone who studies the future and makes predictions about it based on current trends. As you can imagine, it's a fascinating profession to be in and one that we love to explore. And so joining me today to discuss the behaviours of a great futurist is McCrindle's principal and futurist himself, Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Good to be with you.
It's a topic that we love to talk about, our own profession and the ins and the outs. And we've got our trends of 2025 coming up. It's one of our flagship events where we literally talk about the trends set to shape the year ahead. And I always make the joke at the beginning of presentations that I say, oh, people think that we're futurists, and we are, and they then conjure probably up images of crystal balls, and I say, no, a far more accurate depiction of who we are and what we love is this. And then I reveal, you know, a slide of Steve Carell from, I think it's Anchorman, and underneath it says, I love Excel, and it's a nerd-like sort of picture. And I say, you know, we're futurists at heart, and that's how we predict the trends. So it's always a fun, I think, topic to talk about, a fun profession to be in, a super fascinating one, as I said. And Mark, you've kind of pioneered, of course, everything we do here at McCrindle. So I wondered if you could tell our listeners a little bit of the backstory as to how you became a futurist.
Yes, going back to the past to talk about being a futurist, there's something about that. My interest was always people, and I studied psychology and then moved into this field of sociology or social research and data analytics as part of that as well, demographics. And I think that provides a perfect platform to be a futurist, as opposed to those perceptions that you mentioned that people have. You know, futurists aren't just picking up ideas or bring a bit of sci-fi to it or thinking about technology or where could it be. It doesn't start with blue sky thinking. It starts with a base of data from which we extrapolate forward. It's often been said that demographics is destiny. And that's a famous and accurate truism, because if you look at a demographic trend line, that predicts the future. You know, the aging of a population, that's going to flow through, or population growth. And so data gives us the perfect springboard to predict what's next, particularly if you have robust data sets and you have a bit of triangulation on the data set. You look at a few aspects like maybe demographics and generational change and maybe some input from technology or broader social trends. So what we get to do in terms of surveying populations and running in-depth interviews or getting open-ended responses from people in mass survey forms, or indeed running in-depth interviews or focus groups, as well as then analyzing data sets, it gives us this rich foundation of data. And in that data, we see patterns, we see trends and changes. And by winding those forward, you get to see where we're going. And so that is the perfect base from which to be a futurist. It's evidence-based, it's scientific, it's founded in something, and therefore we've got a robust and plausible reason as to saying, here is where we're headed, here's what the next few years holds.
Yeah, absolutely. And I also love that our futurist approach is based on various sort of mega trends, we call them. And I think back to the days of studying dystopic fiction or whatever it might be, where they kind of take one part of society, and often it's technology, and they take it to its logical end, I remember learning about, and it's that's how you get the robots running the world. And I think there's a lot of fear that can be around the future of how technology is pacing, and it's important to be aware of that. But I also think about and enjoy sharing with people about how our approach is to look at, of course, technology, but also other trends as well. And it's looking at different areas, not just one area, but like you said, the demographic trends that will shape the future of work, not just how AI is pacing. And so, yeah, it's, I think, a really good balanced way that we do it. And we try and look at, of course, the positives and be aware of the negatives and paint a realistic picture of what the future is going to be like. And yeah, you've really led that, Mark, and you've developed a team of futurists and a team of social researchers who love to do that. As you think about a futurist, what do you think are some of the behaviours that kind of characterise our profession?
Well, there's seven of them that we've thought through and written up, and maybe we could talk through those. And with the practical application here, that these hopefully can be applied to all professionals, indeed to all of us in our roles and areas, whether it be in a community role or whether it be in a workplace or leadership role in another form, because leaders have to look down the road further than their team. That's why they can take them there. They have to look to the horizon and work out the trends. And so being a futurist, thinking about what's next, is important for leaders of all forms, parents as they think about their children in the future, all of us as we manage the finances or have input into a society or hopefully shape things for the better, we need to put a futurist hat on. And so hopefully there are some tips here that all of us can apply so that we can not only see the trends, but therefore be armed or proactive, ready to respond to those trends and in some ways shape those trends if they're not looking good to a more positive outcome. So the first is to be multifactorial rather than linear. That is to get a broad array of data sets rather than just look at one trend. I remember looking at a futurist book. The best futurist books are the ones written 30 years ago about life today, and you can see whether they were accurate or not. And one that I looked at called How to Survive the 2000s, so it was written some decades back about the time that is now long since passed. It was saying that because of all of the new labor-saving devices, the emergence of the PC, the computers, that we'd have in the future, in these early 2000s, increased leisure time. Now, I haven't seen that come to pass, and I'm not too sure too many have. And that's because they took one trend of computerization, and we might today talk about AI, and say, wow, the robots will take over and we'll just let them do our jobs. But that's not human nature. If we add to the technology lens, a human or a sociological lens, we'll recognize that humans want to be productive. We want to add value. We want to feel that we've put effort in and shaped something. And so that's, and therefore there's not going to be increased leisure time. We're going to apply that increased leisure that comes from reduced drudgery or more productivity into other areas to transform. That's what makes us satisfied and get that sense of shaping things and having impacts is you know, using our skills to a higher order. And if we can outsource something to technology, we will, and we'll turn our time and attention and effort to shape something else. So in other words, you look at technology and where that might head, sure, but you also look at the timeless human drivers, or you look at demographic trends or other factors in that, and that holistic perspective gives you a more plausible perspective of the future. In other words, you triangulate on the future by getting a few angles on it, not just pick one point and think that based on that extrapolation, that's where we're going. So that's to be multifactorial rather than linear, to get a broad array of data sets rather than just pick one and project that forward and then think, well, that's what the future holds.
Yeah, I think that's really wise. And yes, I love that we get to do that. And it makes it for a very interesting profession as well, and quite a hard one, I think, at times as well, because you think, oh, it's almost simpler if you were just looking at one, but also not like very accurate. It's very biased. But like you said, when you look at technology and the future of work, but then you think about demographic trends that are shaping that and what industries will be in demand, that's the one that I find a lot of people tend to focus on, is, oh, robots are coming to take our jobs. But like you said, well, what about aged care? And what about construction? And what about all these other things that population movements are driving in terms of change and how we're going to work in the future? So yeah, that's a very wise one to begin with. Thank you, Mark. What's the second one?
Well, it follows from that, and it's think generational, not just statistical. So statistics give us the what, but they don't give us the why. You know, data will paint a picture in numbers, but it doesn't give us the color, the qualitative. It's quantitative, but it doesn't give us that nuances to the human story. But the generations do. So if we want to know what the 2050s hold, let's understand Generation Alpha and the soon to be emerging Generation Beta. In other words, let's not just forecast the future based on the numbers of today. Let's add the human side to that, the generational lens, to predict the future. We know what 2050 will be like because the parents of 2050, Generation Z, are around today. The workers emerging in the 2050s, Generation Alpha, are around today. In other words, if we want to think about 10, 20, 30 years into the future, and we need to because there are investments, there's school buildings taking place or city planning taking place or budgets that have that sort of time frame in mind. If all we do is just think that we'll look at the data set of today and try to picture what that'll look like in 30 years, we'll probably get a bit off track. Even to think what 3 years will look like is hard just from a numbers perspective. But if we look through the generational lens, who we have, their attitudes, expectations, behaviors, sentiments, perspectives, upbringing, values, that gives us a pretty coloured picture of the future. Now, yes, they will change as they age, as they grow, but much of who we are generationally and as cohorts or groups is set in those formative years. So I think we can get a pretty good indicator as to what the future will hold by looking at the lens of the generations of today and thinking through that perspective. So that's think generational, not just statistical.
And it reminds me actually of our South by Southwest talk, because I think our session topic was Shaping 2050, the Rise of Generation Alpha. And if we just spoke in statistics, I think people would kind of get lost. And whereas when you humanize it, when you humanize the stats, and it's almost easier in some ways to be like, let's think about what a Gen Alpha will be like in 2050. Like you said, we have them already today. We know what their parents are like. We can extrapolate that forward. So I think to see that human story is so relevant, and it connects with all of us because we can relate. We're all human beings. So that's super important. So great insight there, Mark. How about number three?
It's to be practical, not just theoretical. So the future is not some sort of two-dimensional picture that we might sort of have. That's often the portrayal that people give of the future, that as they sketch out what 10 or 20 years will be like, or what living in this decade will be like. You end up with almost like a cartoon picture. It's sort of theoretical in a lot of ways. It's not nuanced, and it seems almost a caricature of life today. But if we think practically about the future, I think we can get a better and true perspective, and we can start, you know, basing some real numbers or investments or plans around that. So by practical rather than theoretical, I'm saying let's not just paint a picture in numbers. Let's think about the needs and the aspects. Let's think about what we need to do now to prepare for that. Let's think about the scenarios, and if that's the future, or some possible scenarios or futures, what do we need to do now to ensure we have the more optimal scenario rather than the more impaired scenario? So let's think in all its dimensions about the future and think about it practically. You know, we will embody this future. Certainly, if we stretch it further, our children or the next generation will. And so let's take a practical lens to it. Let's think about what we can do to get there. Let's think about what we need to do now to plan for that. Let's think about how we can shape it to better prepare for it. Think in terms of practical ways rather than just theoretical ways, because the future is not an inevitable destination that we will one day inherit, but it's something that we shape based on decisions of today, and they need to be practical and informed decisions. We need to be proactive as we plan for the future rather than just theoretical.
Absolutely. And I don't know if anyone else listening was conjuring up the Jetsons when you were talking about those cartoons, but that definitely came to mind. Number four is observe tides, not waves. I know it's an analogy and a metaphor that we like to use, that you've used before, and I find that really helpful, a really helpful one. Could you elaborate on that for our listeners?
Yeah, definitely. Well, you know, waves are dramatic. We go to the beach and people surf waves or get dumped by waves or try to avoid the waves. And yet all the while, well, the focus is on the waves, the tides are transformative. The tides are coming in and the tides are going out. We don't so much see them, but that's actually where the power is. If you look at erosion on rivers, or if you look at global flows of water, it's the tides that are impacting, not the waves. And any good boatie out there is aware of tides, not just waves. And so it is with the trends. Waves might be something dramatic that's suddenly impacted, everyone's talking about, it's the latest technological invention or popular culture events, and it attracts a lot of attention. But that wave will come, and that wave may well go. It's maybe more of a fad than something transformative. But the tides, while they're getting less attention, are transformative. A tide, for example, the demographics. See, a lot of people don't focus on demographics, but they transform a society in terms of demographic growth, or in some places demographic decline. Maybe declining birth rate, that'll have big impacts over the decades ahead. Think about China's one-child policy, which they introduced half a century ago, and now it's the population on the planet with the highest aging curve and massive challenges around finding an emerging generation. Tides, things like demographics or long-term economic shifts, or maybe a below-the-radar shift in consumer behavior will lead to the rising of industries and the declining of industries. It'll lead to the end of some jobs. Think in the manufacturing area. Think in publishing, the decline of newspapers. Just think of some of these tides that come slowly, but over the long term, wholly transform a society. So let's not just look at what attracts our attention in terms of waves and the fads and the current thing. Let's look at those broader societal shifts that come over the longer term, the tides that change a society or a world over a decade or two or three.
Yeah, and I always think about the demographics, like you said, as maybe the one that's not as new or exciting or interesting, but has such important transformative effects. And as you were talking, I feel like this kind of point also highlights the aspect of a futurist in terms of, like you started with, looking back and almost being aware of what trends have come before, what are those longer term ones. So it's almost like counterintuitive to look back, to look forward, but it's an important part of it all as well. How about number five? What's number five, Mark?
Think global, not just local. And we tend to have good knowledge of our local area. Maybe we're focused on our local or our state or our national perspective on things. That's just understandable because we're aware of our particular localized context. But we're in a globally connected world, and it's the global trends, not the local ones, that are key to keep an eye on. I mean, we need to keep an eye on both. But if something's happening over there, it's going to, chances are, impact us here. That's the nature of things. And so being aware of that is so key. I was looking at some research showing that a lot of young people, even here locally in our country, know the new president-elect of the United States, whereas they didn't know the current premier of their state. And that tells me the impact of global events, even above local ones. It's a globalized news feed that young people get. It's global technologies and platforms on which they connect. It's global jobs and even global educational opportunities. It's global trends that shape them, not just those local ones. So make sure, as with our futurist hats on, we take a broad purview of things, not just a current and local one, to ensure we're including those big impacts that maybe take a little longer to hit our shores, but will surely come.
And it reminds me of a question that I'm sure you get asked, because I get asked it a fair bit, around Generation Alpha, younger people who are very globally connected, and oftentimes we'll talk about that characteristic of theirs, and then people will ask, oh, well, are there any nuances locally? And the answer is, of course, there's going to be nuance to local context, but these younger people, these younger generations are more globally connected than ever before. And that president-elect kind of insight is quite an interesting one as well, in terms of, yeah, oftentimes we're more aware of big global events that get a lot of attention in the media landscape compared to maybe more localized ones. And sometimes it's also that idea that young people might know what's going on in global events more than their local neighborhood or their neighbors, which is quite an interesting shift around community and engagement and technology. So again, all the trends coming together multifactorial is always a good thing. So that's a really good one as well. How about trend number six, Mark?
Adjust sales, not change wins. And that's sales, S-A-I-L-S. And that's another metaphor. Think about someone out there on the oceans navigating where they want to go, thinking about the direction they want to head. That old saying is so true. You can't change the direction of the wind, but you can adjust the set of your sails. And that's what a futurist focuses on. They'll look at the winds. And, you know, whether the wind's blowing this way or that, whether it's a headwind or a tailwind, they can't change that. Doesn't worry them. I mean, they'd love to have tailwinds rather than headwinds, but headwinds will come. They'd rather have a moderate wind than a really gusty one. But whatever the winds, and from wherever the direction, they can adjust the set of their sails. They have the agency to be proactive, to respond even amidst that trend that they're in, that wind that is coming. And so it's just an encouragement for us to think about what will we do in response to that. We can't just wish away that trend. We can't hope that the wind comes in our direction rather than working against us. We have what we have, and we have to respond practically. And therefore, it's about thinking, what can we do in response to this trend? What must we do to adjust the angle of our sails to take advantage of the set or the direction of the wind? And, you know, some people see threats as the wind changes, and some people see opportunities. And there's always both of those that come with a wind change. So let's be aware, let's be realistic, let's be proactive, and let's adjust the sails to respond to the realities of our context.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a really great one. And it, even as you were talking there, reminds me, I think, yes, we're demographers and we are welcomed onto stages as people who speak a lot of events as demographers, but just hear you speaking then probably makes me think that we're more futurists, because we are those people that hopefully help inform, and in an inspiring way, people of those trends, leaders of these trends shaping the future, so that we can encourage people to respond to it, to have agency over it, not just sit in that state of sort of apathy or fear, but actually to, like, we're not motivational speakers, but I find that motivating and inspiring that we can come in and give insight and give a lot of data in a fun, interesting way, and then people can be informed and equipped with an understanding of what might shape the future, so that if they're a leader in their house, organization, business, community, whatever it might be, they can actually have agency over that. They don't have to kind of operate in that state of fear or apathy. Yeah. So,
yeah, exactly. And the final one flows on from that. And it's another one for us to keep in mind as we action these trends as futurists, and that is have a realistic perspective, but an optimistic posture. We've got to, people say, well, should you be realistic or optimistic? Well, of course, you should be both. Realistic in terms of our perspective, in terms of our analysis, we've got to be clear-eyed. We've got to take the wins as they come. But we need to be optimistic in our posture. That is to lean forward in our posture, to be proactive, to be responsive. I think that we can make the best of things even when the worst comes our way. And so we need to accept the realities of the situation. That's being realistic. That's being proactive in terms of accepting the brutal realities that we have, but being proactive or optimistic or positive around our response to that. And whenever I hear someone talking in a business meeting, and I get to sit in on a few often before we're about to present some of our findings, maybe it's a board meeting or a company-wide meeting, and a leader is up there in the business saying, oh, we hope the next quarter is this, or we're hoping that the year ahead brings that. That doesn't give me much confidence, because there's no place for hope. Hope defined in this context as fingers crossed, you know, I'm really just hoping that chance-wise this comes our way. What people who are being led need to hear is that, you know what, if we get a quarter like we just had, tough as it was, we have some plans in place. But if we get a quarter like we've seen over on average over the last 5 years, then here's where we're going to go, and this will be the tailwind and the benefit it'll deliver to us. In other words, we have to be realistic. We can't hope for the future. We can't choose the better one. We might get the worst one. The old saying of prepare, be ready for the worst, but hope for the best. Sure, and so whatever comes, we are going to be realistic in our preparedness, but we're going to be optimistic to take advantage, to respond proactively and appropriately, to make the most of it. So yes, a perspective that's realistic, even though our orientation or our posture is optimistic, so that we can bounce back whatever comes, and we're not taken by surprise. We're not going to be burned out or bent out of shape or give up or quit when tough times come. We're realistic and prepared for it. But if it's good, all the better. And if it's not, we've got a plan in place. That's the way we roll.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a really great piece of advice for leaders. And I love the tension of that as well. Like, almost like two, not opposite things, but you can be two things that are seemingly quite different at the same time. There's definitely something poetic and very wise in that. And it kind of links to this final question mark after hearing these seven behaviours of a great futurist. Are there any sort of pitfalls you think that we as futurists, or anyone who is wanting to become more like a futurist or have the behaviours or be a leader that exhibits those behaviours we've talked about today, any pitfalls that you think we need to be aware of as we look and think about and predict and talk about the future?
Well, firstly, not just to go on the gut, not just to go on a sentiment or what we think the future will hold or what we think is key. I would say get that evidence base, get the data, lay your hands on whatever you can, you know, read up, get across research, and we produce a lot of that. And that's why companies do engage research. It's why they'll commission a survey of their customers. It's why they'll get a pulse of their team members, so that they've got the evidence. They know what's happening, and they're not going to be taken by surprise. And they can start to see a pattern is emerging here. There's a sentiment coming. There's a shift in our behavior of customers at the moment. There's an emerging issue with our team. We want to get onto that. Being aware of it is being forearmed, and then you can respond. So get all the data that you can. That's the first thing. Be evidence-based. Go broad with that data. You might move outside of your industry to get data. Even understanding the popular culture, all of that back to the multifactorial side will help you get an evidence base. But don't discount the gut. And that's the next thing, because you know your context better than anyone else does. Think about your particular role in your particular company, in your particular location. I would say to the listener, you are the world expert on that. There's no other person that can make that decision better than you, because you're there, you're in the role, you know the people, you know the context. So go broadly for the data, but ultimately you have to distill that through your perspective, through your experience, through your knowledge, and you do have a little bit of intuition there that I think will guide that decision. And you know, step forward, and you might have to adjust, adapt, pivot, respond as you go. But it's a mix of both a sense of what's the data saying and what do I think I need to do. And that is the difference between a data-driven manager who makes a decision purely based on the numbers and a leader who says, I've distilled these numbers in the equation with that sense that I can't sort of always put numbers on. All of those touch points and signals and flags and factors in my leadership role, and I'm going to step out as a leader and make a decision in this way, even though it's not 100% backed by every bit of data, but I think based on the circumstances with a good evidence base, this is the way we go. So it's being evidence-based and having that place for that experience, for that leader's decision, for that broader knowledge, and stepping forward based on those aspects, I think is important.
Absolutely. And it's such great insight. And I know that that's the power of research as well. It's not replacing the gut feel, it's confirming or denying the gut feel and challenging and creating discussion and debate, which is always really great and healthy for teams and boards and organizations. So yeah, fascinating insights today, Mark. Thanks for, taking the lid off and peering into the work that we get to do as futurists, and for bringing our listeners along. It's always great to have you on the podcast.
Oh, thanks, Ash, and looking forward to hearing more of those futurist stories that listeners step out on as futurists making big decisions for the future. We need everyone to think that way and make great decisions for what's to come.
Yeah, absolutely. And if anyone is listening and very interested in the future and in 2025, I'd definitely encourage you to come along to our Trends of 2025 virtual event. We'll be sharing some great data-led, gut-confirming, denying, hypothesizing, you know, research there. So we're preparing that busily at the moment, and we're really looking forward to that. So thanks again, Mark. And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, we would recommend subscribing to McCrindle Plus for exclusive access to our latest reports, infographics, and masterclasses. Of course, you can also hit follow on this podcast or catch us on social media. So as always, thank you for listening, and bye for now.